And we are live. Hello and welcome to the 2021 Investor Insights Series sponsored by PNC. Tonight's event is New Technologies for Old Industries. My name is Todd Fetterman, and I'm the Managing Director of North Coast Ventures. For those of you not familiar with North Coast, we're based in Cleveland and made up of over 350 individual investors across six separate funds. These funds include both angel funds and more traditional venture capital funds. Before we get started, I'd like to take a moment to thank PNC, our sponsor for tonight's event, and also our sponsor for the full 2021 Investor Insights Series. As many of you know, PNC has a strong commitment to economic development and the entrepreneurial community, so it's a natural for them to support an event like this. Over the past several years, I've gotten to know Pat Pastore, PNC's regional president, as well as John Beer, who leads the PNC Private Bank in Cleveland. Can't say enough about their support and the partnership that they've provided to the North Coast family. And please know that I'm always happy to make an introduction if you have any questions about your personal wealth management needs. So thanks again to PNC, not only for their sponsorship here, but also for their continued support of the broader entrepreneurial community. I'd also like to thank North Coast Ventures Innovation Council. This is a group of over 20 individual organizations who rolled up their sleeves, written a check, and committed to engaging with North Coast, our portfolio companies, and the entrepreneurial community. This group is called upon for voice of customer, perspective on diligence, and also opening doors for potential partnerships with our companies. It's a terrific program, and we thank all of those who are participating. Well, I'm excited to talk about the topic of new technologies for old industries. As a baseline for the conversation, I'm sure everyone here is familiar with Marc Andreessen's concept of software eating the world. It is. But importantly, it's not in a way that's evenly distributed across industries and geographies. Adoption of technology is slower in some areas versus others, and certainly slower in some industries versus others. Part of what we'll discuss here is how technology is viewed and adopted differently in these areas and how it creates a distinct market opportunity for some of our companies. Another way to think about it is through the lens of crossing the chasm. This starts with early adopters, of course, and in a consumer world, any individuals that are placed on the continuum may be skewed slightly differently by region or across demographics or psychographics, but there's a general distribution across that curve. In B2B, however, I would suggest that the placement on the continuum is much less evenly distributed. And that's really the idea here of addressing how and when technology ventures are likely to be successful when catering to more traditional industries. With that, I will ask our panelists to turn on their cameras and join us. Thanks to all of you in advance for being with us here today. Let's start with brief introductions, and we'll start with Chris Ward from PNC.
Perfect. So good to meet everybody this evening. I'm Chris Ward. I lead our innovation, data, analytics, and digital channels for the wholesale bank at PNC.
Great. Chris Beck.
Hi, Chris Beck, the CEO of Performax. Performax is an end-to-end platform that enables businesses selling insurance to manage their clients' life insurance policies as an asset. And some of our largest customers are, you know, the country's largest firehouses, broker-dealers, and banks.
Nathan, bring it home.
Hey, everyone. Nathan Hurd, CEO and co-founder of Healthy Roster. We are an athletic trainer, software, and telehealth platform. And we are helping employers reduce workplace injuries by bringing athletic trainers to every employee on every shift in every location for companies.
Terrific. So let's dive in and have the first question here be for Chris Ward. Chris, you know, the idea of making the most of a business's liquid assets is certainly not new, but the world of treasury management has gotten a lot more sophisticated over the past decade. So can you share for us a bit about just how you approach treasury as a product and how that's evolving?
Yeah, so the way I think about it is what I call the three eyes of the economy. So the first eye of the economy is the immediate economy. So in today's world, right, when you order pizza at home, right, that pizza company, you know, you're expecting immediate gratification that the order was placed and knowing when that order is going to come to you. And if you think about ordering coffee at Starbucks, go down the list, whatever it is that you're doing in your personal life, you're wanting that immediate interaction. Now that is also coming to B2B context in many different forms. The second eye of the economy, of the three eyes of the economy, is an interconnected experience. So when you're doing something, you expect to have a very interconnected experience. Back when we were traveling, and you could have an expense report, and you your receipt came automatically into your expense reporting system, that's an example of an interconnected experience in the business context. In a consumer context, your pizza joint didn't create the little car icon, didn't create the map, didn't create the satellite GPS. But when you can watch your pizza being driven from the store to your house on your phone, that's the interconnected experience that you're experiencing. And then the last three eyes of the economy is the interrupted economy. And I came up with the three eyes of the economy for COVID. So I know everybody wants to focus on COVID. But really, if you think about in today's world, the economy is being interrupted. If you were a Ford or Chevy dealer, you thought you were competing with Mazda or Toyota down the road. Now you're competing with Vroom or Carvana, right? If you're Marriott or Hilton, you thought you were competing with Hyatt. Now you're competing with somebody's flat that's being rented out on any number of services. So as we think about treasury management today, businesses are really having to think about, hey, I've got contract workers today versus maybe I had employees yesterday. Maybe today I'm dealing with work today, get paid today. Like work today, get paid today doesn't work with writing a check to pay somebody, or doesn't work with running batch ACH that's maybe going to happen tomorrow or 2 days from now. So the world is moving to the need for real-time payments and interconnected payments, because once again, moving money without information is useless, because if you don't know what the money's for, you don't actually know how to apply it to your business. So as I think about, as we're designing products or capabilities, what companies want, what consumers want who are interacting with companies or businesses interacting with one another, they really want to know immediacy. They want an interconnected experience because they don't want to be interrupted, or they don't want their business to be interrupted, or they're trying to be an interrupter in the marketplace. So as we think about designing things, we're thinking about in the context of those three eyes of the economy and making sure that everybody can have everything at their fingertips.
Terrific. Let's shift to Chris Beck. Chris, Performex is an interesting example of bringing a technology to a legacy industry. You help your customers, which are largely insurance agents, establish a new level of visibility they've never had before. And they can take action by selling customers the right policy at the right time, which obviously has an ROI for them. Can you just share a little bit more about how this works in practice?
Yeah, basically what our platform does is allow an insurance agent or financial advisor who has clients that or multiple policy owners that they serve to understand what those the sort of status of those policies are at any given time and what actions they should be doing. So, in the financial advisory space, there's, this concept called, next best action, next best recommendation. And so I think for us, it's next best sort of question and conversation. So what we do is give the advisors knowledge around what's happening with their client-specific policies. We take data on that client that our customer has provided and use that as context to understand whether that policy is meeting the objectives that that client had or not. And so I think traditionally this is something that's very foreign to the life insurance space. Often life insurance is purchased for a particular reason. Somebody might buy life insurance because they want, protection if something happens to them. Other people buy life insurance because it's a wealth accumulation asset, right? They're, or tax efficiency asset. And so what our solution does is really measures, what is that policy being purchased for? And then over time, because these policies are very long lifetimes, how is that policy then behaving and what is the status of that policy relative to what the plan was or what the expected use was? And so I think for us, it's a little bit different because we're changing the mindset of the industry. I think, historically, life insurance has been something that's been sold and put in a drawer and sort of forgotten about. In some policies, I don't know that it's ever okay to do that, but it's sort of okay to do that, right, with the term policy. If there are other policies that have, you know, that are, you know, invested assets or have cash investments in them, those really do need to be monitored and reported on more like a traditional investment asset. And so I think for us, you know, helping to change the industry mindset to be one more consumer focused, right? Making sure and delivering on the promise of the life insurance, not only when something happens, but also throughout the consumer journey. But then two, just helping get the industry to a place where they really are managing these life insurance policies as assets in a larger financial plan. So really that's really what we're seeing is, you know, it's not just putting, you know, a product in the market, but also there is a, you know, adoption of a new way of thinking. And certainly there are regulations that are helping us with that, you know, to be completely candid, right? The regulatory environment's changing. But I think that's really it. And a lot of these older industries, when you're trying to, you know, introduce technology, a lot of it is around being able to, you know, understand the context of why the industry is the way that it is and where it needs to go and help people along that path. I mean, you talked about, you know, closing the chasm a little bit earlier before when, you know, we were sort of on, and that's really it. You've got the early adopters and the market is going the direction that we expect it to go in terms of consumer protection and more forward thinking and proactiveness. But that's really it, I think, in a lot of these older industries is how do you get that frame of mind to change within that industry?
Very good. So Nathan, let's shift to you. You mentioned before that Healthy Roster's customers are largely manufacturing and distribution facilities. So it's harder to get older school than that. Help us understand who the economic buyer is for a software package like this. And from their perspective, what is the problem that Healthy Roster is solving?
So, you know, our company is dedicated to improving the care that athletic trainers give to their athletes and employees. And so we built a platform that allowed athletic trainers who are in the field to easily take notes on injuries and then communicate through telehealth with all the people that are connected to those athletes. And then we saw that athletic trainers were working in the industrial fields and started catering to them. And athletic trainers in the employer field, what they do is they're on staff and they're in the field taking care of employees who are getting the same types of injuries as athletes at work, which are musculoskeletal injuries. So that's repetitive use, that's stretching and flexing and injuries that happen when you're active at work as well. When we started moving into the industrial space, we started selling to safety managers and VPs of safety. And, you know, software is not exactly something that they use on a daily basis. They're on the floor, they're in their distribution or warehouse environments. And, you know, using software is just not top of mind. Taking care of their employees is. So what we're doing is bringing, you know, something relatively new and specifically mobile software to them to make their lives a little bit easier. And so we are facing an uphill battle of, hey, this is software that can make your life easier, but also the benefit of it really does make, you know, it much easier to use that it's mobile and they can use it on the floor. So it's kind of a mix. We're going into an old school environment with a new school tool that really does improve the day-to-day lives of the people who are using it and managing it.
Great. So, you know, back to Chris Ward, we'll give you the big philosophical question here. You know, we talked a little bit about crossing the chasm here, and I'm guessing if, you know, our viewers could raise their hands, most of them would say, "Yep, familiar with it, understand exactly what it means as far as a technology adoption cycle." You know, there's a quote in that book, which is our attitude toward technology adoption becomes significant anytime we're introduced to products that require us to change our current mode of behavior or modify other products and services that we rely on. So I think that's another way of saying that we embrace technology a little differently when we have to do something different or that's uncomfortable or that we haven't done before. And that's probably even more pronounced in the kinds of industries that we're talking about today. So can you share just a little bit more with us about that dynamic and what we should understand about bringing technology to markets that are disproportionately composed of the kinds of buyers that Jeffrey Moore might have called late majority or even laggards?
Yes, I think it's a great example of, you know, how you design a platform for today's world, right? So if you just take, for example, real-time payments in the U.S., a really great example of how we built TM as a platform is to think about, hey, we've got customers who are going to be on different stages of the journey. So if you're an employer who is facing work today, get paid today, and you're forced into figuring out different ways to pay your employees quickly, you might decide, hey, I'm just going to re-engineer for that today because I've got a labor shortage. You know, it's hard not to imagine somebody without a labor shortage today, but somebody might be more acute than others. And so they might be willing to adopt the new technology quickly. So great, use APIs, platform works that. But then there are customers who are like, hey, listen, I don't want to change any of my systems, but I kind of want to take advantage of the new world order. And we engineer to take the old ways and convert that to the new way. So it's like doing currency translation for a customer or whatever, right? So, you know, we see that all the time. And you'd be surprised at actually the tech companies that we see who might have a great tech front end, but their payments plumbing is kind of like the old world order. And we help them, you know, bridge the old world order to the new world order relative to payments as an example. So we think of it as a platform play. We think of it as ways in which you've got to actually design for the different types of customers that you have and help them along the journey. There, you know, even some of the old line, you know, customers that you might be thinking about, there's nuggets of them that want to accelerate certain things fast, and there's others that not so much. And whether it's a customer that's upgrading their ERP package, right, and they're trying to take advantage of modern technology, introduces opportunities for modern space. And I think Nathan talked about it really well in his example of like, hey, old line company trying to use new software, trying to take it onto the factory floor, so to say. You got to work to bring all those pieces together. Next Best Sell is another great example that Chris mentioned as well. Like a lot of times, you know, in that old line industry, that's another great example of like, hey, I'm trying to get them walk before they need to run. And we've seen that on multiple ways to bring real-time payments. Or I bet you people on here view Zelle or PayPal or other things. You know, if you enable it, eventually when the time comes, they'll use it. But if you give them bridges, they actually might start to use it faster. Hopefully that helps.
It does. So Chris to Chris. So, you know, Chris Ward said, one of the things he's thinking about is just the design for the different types of customers that you have. And Chris Beck, you have on one hand these huge publicly traded financial companies, behemoths, where they probably have 50 people who are going to roll up inside your technology for a security review. But you also have 1, 2, and 10 person shops as somebody who just needs a solution to help them sell more insurance and keep their insurance customers happy. So how do you manage that continuum of type of customer, of sophistication in a relatively unified product?
Yeah, I think the biggest thing for us is that we have multiple experiences in the product. And so our advisor facing product is very similar, whether you're in a large organization or whether you're in our sort of direct to advisor product. There is other features and functions that are available to the large institutions and the home offices. And so I think for us, it is, you know, a lot of it was just over time understanding which features were appropriate for which market segments and who used what, right? And it sounds pretty simple, but in the early days when you're trying to figure out what a product should be, product market fit, and what features you should have, it is not easy in the early days. Like it sounds very easy, like in hindsight, but really that's it. You know, we see adoption You know, when we built out the product, we built it out for, you know, our founder, Mike Pepe, was a very long, you know, 25-year life insurance agent, had a like big book of business with, you know, specific sort of kinds of policies and things like that. And what we had found was we actually built the first version of the product as like a super user product. And then we had to sort of come back and say, okay, you know, everybody's, our goal is to get everyone there at some point, but out of the gate, right, you have to meet them where they're at, to Chris's point. And we ended up paring back, frankly, some of the features in the early versions of the product or in certain segments where they only get certain features of the product, because we found that those are the really core ones that they use. And we just sort of stripped out features that they didn't use from their user experience. And so I think that's just part of the product market fit, like continuum, if you will. But, you know, in the place that we're at, where, you know, it's really like professional enterprise user versus large enterprise, you know, it's hard to manage those two things at the same time. And the way to do that is really to hopefully create, and what we did was create like a platform that allowed us to be very, have a lot of flexibility and configurability to make sure that we're sort of tuning the product to the needs of our customers, whether it's somebody who's just sort of early in the process and starting to walk, or somebody who is a super user and can use all the features that we have.
Yeah. So Nathan, we've clearly established here, we're talking about markets and buyers that are not early adopters typically. How does that change though, how you identify, segment, and then really engage, right, through marketing and sales tactics, these prospects in the real world? I imagine that who you're talking to defines how you think about finding them, how you talk to them, and then how you follow up from there. Can you tell us more?
Yeah, so, you know, we started in the sports medicine space and saw exactly what everybody's been talking about, which were early adopters, were the first to the platform. They were the first to give us the best ideas on features that they thought would be good. And then figuring out who to listen to became our most important job. Which type of customer was going to be our bread and butter? And from those early adopters, we built out the platform and then started adding features, you know, along the way. When we pivoted, you know, for the market segment, we went into the industrial side, where we were starting to sell to a different group. What we found is there's still early adopters in that group, right? There's just less of them. And so our job in identifying in the sales funnel is what type of prospect is this? Is this one of the early adopters? And to really focus the time and energy on better segmenting and identifying early adopters within the new group. That's hard. It takes a lot of time, and obviously in our space there aren't a lot of them, but the ones that are, that's the gold, right? So it just takes a little bit more time of focusing, you know, how we do our marketing, you know, our rev ops person became that much more important, right? How do we get HubSpot to fine tune, you know, our marketing messages to the right type of person who's looking at our ads and, you know, kind of tracking and following and trying to really position the story for those early adopters. So we spent a lot of time doing that. They exist, there's just not many of them, so we got to treat them as gold.
Absolutely. Yeah.
One, I just wanted to add one thought. Nathan sort of made me think about it, but you know, I think thinking about the adoption curve, you've got sort of bleeding edge adopters and then leading edge adopters. And I think in the early days, it's really important, you know, as a startup to figure out who they are, right? Because mm-hmm. sometimes your bleeding edge adopters, you know, they might be very purpose-driven. They might also be the super users, right? That see all the things that you see in a product. But I think, you know, understanding where the leading edge people who are the sort of like the beginning edge of the, maybe the middle majority or the early majority, right? Is, you know, that's definitely something that is worth a time investment, right? On the behalf of like any startup, is to make sure that you're thinking about that.
Chris, I'll follow up and say that once you find the leading or bleeding or leading edge adopters, I think one of the key things to do from that point is to get down to the actual user. So sometimes the decision makers have a much more like a higher vision of what your product should be, but the users on the ground floor, those folks may not be as far as into the vision as those folks are. And so you have to be careful not to listen too much to the visionary bleeding edge guy as you are to the person who's using your software every day to build out the right features. We found that early, which was, oh yeah, this grand vision is exactly what I've always wanted in this space. And you guys are going to be the ones to bring it. And the seven athletic trainers that worked for that person were like, yeah, that's not our day to day. We don't live that life. And our biggest pain is X, Y, and Z. Go solve those three. And it was listening to that pain. That's what made it like go from bleeding edge to, you know, an everyday user that was adopting at a much quicker rate because it had the daily solve there.
Mm-hmm. Maybe this is one of the things that partially defines catering to this particular space, but for Nathan and Chris Beck, would you say that most of your customers, when they eventually become customers, were even aware that a solution like yours existed, or were they looking for this, or you just happened to find them?
I think for us, it was a little bit of both. Some people were looking, or it was just also to Nathan's point, like, you know, we were putting marketing messaging out to targeted messaging that allowed us to sort of pull in the kind of people that would see a lot of value from our solution. So I think in the market, because we're a category creator, like nobody else has really done this. Nobody else is, you know, I think that's been harder. You know, it's a little bit of both. Sometimes people are looking for us. A lot of times they don't know exactly what it is, but when they hear what we're doing, they're like, oh yeah, I actually do need that. So.
Yeah, for us, you know, we're replacing something that actually exists in a different form. So athletic trainers have worked in the industrial space for years and have been hands-on on a shift, helping employees who are injured or in ache and pain type mode. What we're doing is we're virtualizing that and bringing telemedicine to the market. And so we're first to do that in the safety industry, or the safety, you know, the safety leaders of each company looking at our platform. But they're very comfortable, or at least understand the value of what somebody who's there can do for their employees. And so our job is to say, yes, having somebody there is fantastic, but you never have somebody there for all of your employees at one location. And there's usually no one there for most of your locations, because most locations in the manufacturing industries are small locations. So you can afford an athletic trainer or a nurse or a PT to come into your bigger locations, but not to your smaller ones. And so all we're doing is saying, look how much you love having somebody on staff. Let's give all of your employees access to that type of resource, and we'll do it virtually. And so once we educate them that it can be done that way and show them the platform, it clicks for them. But there is some education that goes along saying, yeah, look, you love this benefit in real life. Let's show you what it's like when you use telemedicine. So.
And Chris Ward, you mentioned a few relatively new services like Work Today, Get Paid Today. Are there a couple other innovations in fintech that, you know, you feel are worth addressing that maybe were only recently available to traditionally non-tech buyers?
So I think a really good example of that, if we once again could pull the audience and said how many people are doing their cash forecast on an Excel spreadsheet, I guarantee almost 100% of the hands would go up, right? Because if you're a CFO or a treasury analyst or whatever in the CFO's office, are you going to take time to figure out what's the best model to forecast cash, or are you just going to do Excel? You're just going to do Excel, right? And so, you know, you see where like cash forecasting now using AI is a great example of technology that's coming available to businesses to make their life easier. And they can focus on less about constructing the cash forecast and more about actually managing cash. So most people, once again, go back to the CFO's office, they actually are spending more time gathering data, entering it into the Excel spreadsheet, maybe adjusting the formulas or whatever, and then hardly any time on actually what to do about the cash forecast. Now using AI and having, you know, like a bank partner able to synthesize that, give you, you know, the best model that's going to help your business, and then have you spend more time managing. the cash position and what you need to do about it is a really great example of that.
Excellent. So Chris Beck, in all your spare time, you are also an active angel investor. So I'm curious, from that perspective, to what extent are the kinds of markets that we've been talking about here red flags for you as an investor versus real opportunities that you want to run towards and invest in?
Yeah. So I think my background is really in product management too. And so I always think about, when I think about markets and products, I think about, is the problem big, right? Is it pervasive in a large industry? Are people willing to pay for it? So I think from a product standpoint, like all of those are really important. But I think from a investment standpoint, I also think about timing, market timing, right? And I think that's huge. And I'm probably not saying anything that you probably haven't thought at any time, Todd, right? But I think the real magic in a lot of cases of understanding whether any particular product will be adopted or not has a lot to do with timing, right? I think of the business that we're in Performax today, and the early years, when Mike had the product and he was just using it for his own sort of business, his insurance business, he was doing it because he wanted to provide a value-added service to the clients, and he felt like it was really important to protect those clients. Now fast forward to consumer protection, more regulatory, oversight on life insurance and annuity products. And you have an opportunity where a market where they might have been sort of laggards or slow to adopt now has a regulatory component that gives it tailwinds. And so I think timing, for me, I think about red flags are, is the industry, is the timing right of the industry? Is the industry technologically capable of actually executing on this? So that's one of the other, I think, big challenges is a lot of markets and products, are great ideas, but can the industry actually execute on it? And I think, it's a completely gray fine line, right? Because when the market can fully execute on it, everybody has access to it via API. So you can't wait too long, right? So you have to sort of be in that early, that sort of very early stage of, some players can execute on it from a technology perspective. Maybe that's part of your value add, is that you're actually meeting people where they are and giving them the capabilities to do it. But I mean, I think that's sort of where the magic happens and also where the red flags are, right? So if the timing's not right, if the industry, it really isn't situated to be able to, from a technology perspective, actually be able to support the that sort of innovation, those are red flags.
And if I could just pile on to what Chris said, I think this goes back to the platform discussion we were having earlier. Knowing that everybody wants to go to APIs, but they can't get there, right? That's a great, if you can build those bridges, mm-hmm. for the gap to get the people who are, can't change their technology that fast, but want to take advantage of things, I think that's a really important way to think about the design. As we were thinking about real-time payments at PNC, we knew that customers were not going to be able to immediately pull the trigger and use real-time payments using APIs right out of the chute. So that's why we designed solutions to take old mainline files and convert them to real-time payments for them, so they didn't have to do it, right? And that's a great example. As you're designing new products or thinking about tapping into these old ways of doing things, what are the easy bridges you can build that make it easier for the customer to select the new way of doing things? I think Chris said that really well.
Terrific, terrific. So two final questions for everyone, and I'd say feel free to have everybody answer. If you feel like somebody's given your perfect answer, pass and we'll keep going. But number one is just, how has the COVID environment impacted adoption and engagement in your markets? And do you feel that it's different in your specific market than perhaps the market in general? There are no prizes for going first.
I'll jump in first. Let's talk about the negative headwinds, right? So if a corporate customer had a corporate card, right? So T&E spend is way down. So that's the negative, right? Nobody's out taking Ubers, taking customer, traveling on business, right? It's non-existent, right? But on the flip side, all the customers who were trundling into the office to issue checks to make payments are like, oh yeah, this is actually kind of hard now. I can't go into the, maybe I can't go into the office, or like I got a single point of failure. So, you know, maybe I should rely on somebody else to issue those payments for me, right? Like I can approve the payments, but like the actual execution of the payments. So there's massive adoption of different forms of payments, trading away from checks, right? Maybe using card now, maybe using a real-time payment, maybe using more ACH, right? So there's lots of things in terms of, I would, almost every business, even if mainline business, maybe getting orders from customers you're now getting online, you're trying to invoice digitally, you're trying to receive payments digitally. So I think that has accelerated, you know, you see news stories where we've accelerated by a decade or we've accelerated by a couple of years. I don't know where the truth is, but at the end of the day, there's been a huge acceleration of adoption of ways of doing business electronically. Now, on the flip side, I do think people are yearning to actually have face-to-face contact, right? So I'm not sure we're going to permanently stay so far along the spectrum and get a little, I mean, I've personally traveled for business and I feel like I've won more business face-to-face than virtually. I'm sure that, you know, there's probably people who have differing opinions on that, but I do think the personal connection does help. But the digital acceleration is quite aggressive.
Yeah, I'd echo the same thing. And I think that at least in the life insurance industry, they probably, especially on the carrier side, there was more digital adoption in 2020 than probably the last 5 or 10 years combined, right? When like it was really, it's a very paper-based industry. And when the industry was forced to figure out digital solutions, or they'd sort of been on their heels for a long time around digital adoption, like because it was forced, you know, now the industry has just a different level of comfort, right, in operating digitally. And so I think, as Chris said, we'll go back to doing business in person. But I think that, you know, still like the efficiency around the digital process, I think is probably here to stay.
I'll say that, you know, for our business, while our platform does other things, the telehealth piece I think is unrivaled in its acceleration and adoption. So we've gone from basically zero to 80 or 90 in our society's acceptance of telehealth. It really does give such value to people to not have to go out of their house to get certain things taken care of. And so we apply that same thing to the industrial space. It's so nice to be able to have somebody tell you what's wrong without leaving the floor. Both for the employer and the employee. Like nobody wants to go sit in an emergency room and get x-rays to be told they have a strained shoulder. Like they want people to be able to see and talk to them, but not necessarily to go through the hassle of you know, traditional occupational health medicine. So for us, that acceleration has been huge. The negative is COVID has shut down manufacturing at least once or twice already, and it may do it again. And so those elongate the buying cycles because the decision makers have other concerns and worries that they have to focus on.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Final question, and happy to have any all dive in, but what advice would you have for any founders or investors that are interested in bringing innovation to more traditional and maybe non-early adopter markets?
I'll jump in with, like, listen, I think, I view this as it's an interesting dilemma that people have, right? And I'm going to use a little bit of a diversity and inclusion lens on this, in terms of that you've got to actually find people who are not thinking like you and understand the space and get those thoughts together to push and pull on the innovation that you're trying to bring to the market, right? So you absolutely need the people who are the far out thinkers, right? And who are going to push the envelope. But you also need the people who actually understand the customer base that you're going after to actually build those bridges to figure out how you're going to get there, right? So, you know, and in today's world, right, in a really virtual world, sometimes it's really hard to get that diversity and inclusion of thought and engagement because you're not able to read the body language or the other aspects of the business. I really encourage, you know, anybody I'm mentoring or trying to come up with a new idea, in all aspects, try to find a friend that's not like you, whether it be, you know, the way they think about things, whether it be, you know, opposite sex, right? It doesn't really matter. Somebody that's very different that can help you really push on your thinking, and it's going to make a better product and a better solution that you can take, and it's going to prepare you for the objections of the buyer that you're trying to sell something to, so you can anticipate some of those things and figure out how you're going to, you know, get your product to market and get adopted. So I find that to be extremely useful in multiple aspects of managing a business.
I get this asked a lot, both, you know, from organizations like yours, Todd, and then just the Jewel, people thinking about starting up a business. And I usually say the same thing, and it doesn't matter the industry or who your potential customer is, but get the buy before you build. Go out to people either that you know or that you can, that you find, who are interested in hearing about new technology in their space. Sell the idea first, make sure the pain's real and they're willing to pay for it, then go build it. And you can do that in several ways, but there are enough leading edge and bleeding edge adopters that will be willing to partner with you if the pain is real. And that's, you know, we didn't even build Healthy Roster until we had our first yes on a contract. And it was a proposal that was said yes to, and that gave us a runway of 4 or 5 months to launch it. And I can't tell you how important that is. Like, make sure the pain is real and not just painful, but worth paying for to solve.
100%. And I think the, if you're starting a business, Nathan, I think that's a great idea. Like, one of the most incredible pitches that I've ever seen was these two founders had gone and actually gotten letters of intent from about 20 different customers, right? They were raising sort of on the back of that. And I thought that's like a really smart way to do this, right? It proves they'd had the conversations with the people that they needed to, they really understood the problem, and they had customers who were willing to sort of put money behind it. And so I think that's a great idea.
It's hard too, Chris. Like, that's really hard to do, right? And it shows you the kind of the internal, or, you know, kind of the fortitude of those founders, that they're willing to go out without a product and pitch something that they believe in, and then get the conversion, you know, in that sense, being somebody who's committed to actually buying it if you build it. And that says something.
Terrific. That is a great place to leave it. This has been a fun conversation. I'd like to thank each of our panelists for joining us today, and thank PNC for sponsoring our 2021 Investor Insight Series. Before we sign off, though, I'd like to point out that the two entrepreneurs here, Nathan and Chris Beck, are running these category-creating companies. They're off and running, having raised several rounds of capital, grown their teams to 40 or 50 people, and generated meaningful revenue. So they've got a lot of happy customers, and they'd like to have even more. So here's the ask. After hearing a bit about what they do and kind of understanding where they're coming from, if you are connected to an organization that would benefit from working with Healthy Roster or Proformex, please drop me a line or feel free to reach out to anyone on the North Coast Ventures team, and we can definitely help make that connection. We have seen really powerful introductions and game-changing connections happen from these kinds of introductions, and I'd encourage anyone watching to take a moment and think about what doors you might be able to open for these two companies. So with that, thanks again to our panelists. Thanks again to PNC. And we'll look forward to seeing everyone at our next Investor Insights event early in 2022. Take care.
Thanks, Tom.